My name is Dominic. I work for Intel Open Source, and we're going to talk about security. So those who know me, I've been working in security for quite a bit of time. I did a project with British Telecoms, and I work in TV industry where security has been a long tradition. After that, I probably moved to IVI. So the first thing I want to raise really strongly is that a lot of people believe that in embedded, security is a problem mostly for the press, but not for the engineers, not for the management. What we have to realize is that actually attacking IoT is a very viable business. And it's viable for different areas. One that has not yet started, but I expect will start soon. I see people doing photos of the slider. It's very nice things, but I can tell you I've already posted that on the website, so you should have it. So the ransom model that has been very popular in the last 2 years on PCs is certainly going to start in the IoT. So why would you like to ransom? You can stall a manufacturing quite easily. You can lock down the very expensive items. And as I told you, I'm working on automotive Linux. And it's a very interesting proposition to actually lock your car. And one day you will come in the morning, and the only thing your GPS system will display is, please pay, you know, 500 euros in bitcoins before using your car, because you will have to pay. So it's an interesting model. It can be used for competitive advantage, especially when you want to collect R&D or manufacturing data. It's quite badly protected, and they are highly valuable. And you can also disturb production line. I was recently discussing with a guy doing a food in the food industry, and one of his fears is that actually someone with bad intention blocked his manufacturing line before Christmas, because that would kill him. That would completely kill the company. And finally, indirect, and that what we have seen in the last 2 weeks, you may have read in the press that for the first time, a terabyte per second DOS attack was launched against a French cloud provider called OVH. That was the first time ever that a DOS attack actually passed 1 terabyte per second bandwidth. And that was achieved by actually hacking mostly video surveillance camera. So it is definitely a very viable business. And we cannot just say, oh, in IoT, no, we are protected. We only do small devices. Who is going to hack small devices? It's going to happen, and it's already happening. And especially video cameras have been very weak. But there are also examples. You know, Dick Cheney had to get his pacemaker replaced because they realized that actually it was not protected and you could remote activate the emergency mode on it. Not that so many people would try to make any bad thing to Dick Cheney. You know, he's so popular. But no, it's not things that you want to hear. So we really have to understand the risk. And the risk, in one way, is a bit tempting to forget. So if we look at software, we tend to believe that we are all the same, we are all hidden, and why would it be me? For a developer, it's an absolute nightmare to try to look at security. He has to think about all the potential weaknesses. He should have to deactivate every possible user error. And we all assume that long-term support kernel and application are provided for free. So that's the developer side. So when we look at it, yes, if you just take it to the absolute point, you should say, it's so difficult, why to bother? You know, it's too complex. In any case, I will fail. The good thing with security is that you don't have to be good. You just have to be less bad than your neighbor. Okay, it's a system which is moving all the time. It's a bit like, you know, in houses. If you live in an area which is not very safe, if your house is a bit more difficult to to hijacked in, likely it's your neighbor house that will be hijacked. Okay, it's not pleasant, but it's far more pleasant than being your house. If you live in an absolute perfect world, you can leave your house open. You know, I'm lucky enough to live in a place where when I just go, I leave the house open. You know, it's very practical. If a friend visits and he has something to give me, he just can get me in their house, take what he has to take, or put it. But not everybody can do that. In software, we've been behaving in embedded a little bit with the open house policy. Default root password, which are published on the internet, open port, kernel, which are 5 or 10 years old, and which have a few tens of zero-day attack well published. So that is on the development side. Obviously, on the black hat side, so the baddies, in one way, the work is a little bit easier. You just need one security hole. You just need one entry point, and then you're in. And you can trust to be held by careless users and careless developers. You know, that's a good thing when you want to hack a system. You can take as a principle that the user and the developer will have been misbehaving, and so you are going to do social engineering and try to find out who they are. And you see things far worse than just having a post-it with a password glued on a screen. You know, you see terrible stuff. And once again, the long-term business viability is very good. If you think from a return of investment and you put yourself in a black hat situation, it is a very promising business proposition. If you think the cost against the return, it's extremely interesting. And they are well organized. We have a good international network here and in the Linux and open source developer community, but the black hat are not bad at all themselves. You know, they are extremely well organized. They have a good way of sharing information, sharing businesses, sharing tricks. If you go on the dark web, you will find out that people are even grading themselves, so you know what you buy is good, the guy is reliable. Some even provide some after-sales support, okay, in case you would not know how to use a system. So we really need to understand that risk. And that potentially the biggest problem I face today. I've been talking about security and embedded for the last 5 years almost in quite a number of conferences. And quite sadly, I have to say that I have seen very little progress. There is more and more people in the room when I talk. That's the only good thing. You know, when I started 5 years ago, you know, when I had, you know, just a bunch of a few people, and most of them were my friends, who came for support, it was not there. So we start to have a little bit of hearing, but we have difficulty with multiple layers in understanding the risk. The developers, because it's a pain for them, they have to really work harder, and they have to organize themselves, so they're a bit lazy on the side. We have difficulty with the people providing the tools and the continuous integration. When you tell to your QA manager that now he's going to have to sign every single image that he's doing in continuous integration, so the continuous integration test will be done on a signed image, it tells you, yes, this is going to require a specific server, and who is going to provide the keys. And yes, it is difficult. And it's difficult with management. And with management, the difficulty is slightly different. Obviously, they look at the cost, but they also look at the risk. You know, if, as a manager, I say, I am going to provide a secure system, then you have to commit to it. And as a manager, you put your head on the block when you say something like that. So if it doesn't work, you are fired. So they rather keep the statu quo. Now, it's not going to last. So one thing I am sure is that before I will retire, which is not in that long, you see my white hair, it will happen one day, I am sure that security will be taken into account. So that's a good thing. At least I've been talking for a few years in empty rooms, but I can see that it is coming. And it, in coming, the good thing is that we have most of the technology, and we have the capability to really improve the level in one way quite easily. So what are the fundamentals? The first one, you have to minimize the surface of attack. The base rule is that the more you provide services which are not needed, the more you're going to have trouble. So yes, you may have a debug daemon which is running on your system. In production, it should not be there. And the only way to not getting there in production is to remove it from day one and just make it optional so people have to manually install it. You have to control the code which is run. That's something which is done far too little. People start to check licenses, but a lot of people are not running code checker, buffer overrun, stack violations. You have static code analysis you can do, that one step. But also trust your code. Get your developer to sign their code so you know that the code which gets in your Git repository is a valid code. And most of companies I know don't do it. So if a hacker has a capability to get into the system, for example, through a video camera, like it happened not that long ago, they can post code on the Git repo that will become valid code because nobody ever checks that. It's very simple to do it. So trusting your code is interesting. Obviously, provide an upgrade bulletproof model. I will come back on that. I will never insist on the fact enough that the update must be bulletproof. Being available is step number one, which is already a big progress because quite a number of embedded devices, the upgrade process is so difficult that actually it's impossible in the field, but it has to be bulletproof. Tracking security patches, that is potentially something we are quite far away in embedded, in the sense that most of people tend to be stuck with one version that they are using. They are not capable to go to the next release of kernel. They are not capable to go to the next release of the build system. I was discussing yesterday with, you know, in automotive grade Linux, we likely going to have to move to the next Yocto. Now, it's not too difficult, but the natural tendency is to say, no, we're going to stick with the one we have. That's really bad. So you have to put a process which allows that. Use hardware security helper when they're available. Should be done, but most of people still store their key on a disk or on a flash. Stop lateral systems, that's far more complex. We will see how automotive grade Linux does it, but it's a significantly more complex area. And develop and get QA with security turn on. You cannot turn on security later on. And finally, never rely on human. If you want to fail, you rely on human. You know, all developers are good, they are going to take care. No. Customer will change the default password, root password. No. Oh, QA will remove the special extra software we have for debugging before shipping the image to the customer. No. So that doesn't work. You have to get your process which are ticking on. Which probably lead to a first fundamental that security cannot be added after the fact. So if you develop your project without security and you say, oh, we will add security when we are after the proof of concept, you've already failed. The good news is that then you know immediately you have failed. That's practical. But it is a reality. So you really have to sell that to your management very quickly. Why can we not rely on humans? There are two different reasons. The first one is that the people who really understand security, and in particularity in embedded, are almost non-existent. And I just give them a few numbers, okay? We have about, today in the world, 9 million mobile software developers, about 8 million web developers, about 500,000 embedded developers. And out of these 500,000, a handful of them are security aware. So your chance of hiring them or your chance to have one on your team is about the same as the one of winning the lotto by buying a ticket. Okay, it's almost nil. So you definitely cannot rely on that model. It just doesn't work. And if you take IoT, because we are in an IoT summit, where we want to develop numbers varies. Today, people seem to agree on 30 billion devices by 2020. Okay, it was 50 billion a year ago, so it's getting more reasonable. How many developers are we going to need to develop these devices? Actually, we need more developers than we have in embedded world today. So it means that these devices are not going to be developed by embedded developer. That's the first rule you have to realize. They're going to be developed mostly by web developer and potentially mobile developer. So we are going to have to adapt that. And the knowledge of security is, for them, inexistent because that's part of the platform. So on the application, they don't bother with that. And so that is one area. The skills are not available. And the second one is that, as I've already said, and I've repeated because it's difficult for us because we are developers and we tend to believe that the developer are the best people in the world, we are unreliable. Okay, we find any reason to actually put it for tomorrow. Now, I told you the concept are known and the technology are known. So we all know the basic principle of these type of things. The first one is that, no, I cannot do that. Sorry, I wanted to put a mouse, but I cannot. We know that our software is going to run on the hardware. Okay, it's a pain. We all know that software developers, we would love to not have any hardware, but it has some good side effect. Me working for Intel, it allows me to be paid every month. So I'm quite happy you have to run on hardware. But on the hardware, we have a number of areas. Typically, I would put them in three domains. The first one that we all know is the secure boot. Now, depending on the hardware vendor, it can be different. At Intel, it's part of our UEFI model. The secure boot fundamentally allows you to know that the core part that you're going to run on your hardware is known and that your hardware is in a safe state to receive it. That's what it will do for you. Every vendor has that. Then we tend to have a TPM, which is a type of trusted zone in our friends from Cambridge, which allowed to have some safe storage and potentially some safe execution of the dedicated code, which will have very key functions like validation of something, encrypting of something, trying to be available. The final one is probably beginning. It's been available in certain technologies, like in TV, we've been there for years, and mobile. It's coming to traditional embedded, which is capability to manage IDs, which is a very interesting point. It's capability to really have an ID which is specific for every single device. But that's coming from the hardware. So then you put your Linux, and your Linux has to be up to date. Because if it's not up to date, you're going to be in trouble. Now, up to date doesn't mean you have the very latest kernel, but you could work with an LTSI, for example. But you have to put the patches for security. And a lot of people in embedded, what they do, the first thing they do is they do their own kernel. They add a few driver from here and from there, and that's it. That's the end of the maintenance. That's not good, okay? People are laughing, they know that, okay? Then you come to more complex area, and we have capability to harden OSs. It's been in Linux in the cloud for quite a long time, in enterprise. We had capability to harden Linux quite well between the mandatory access control, the name services. We can create domain, we can do restrictions in the APIs that you can call in the kernel. There are plenty of models which are there available. And then you're going to have API and you're going to put your application on top. That is fundamentally describing the base principle that everyone should use. I have a hardware, it has some functionality, and I take benefit of it. I am using Linux or another real-time OS for smaller system, but here I'm talking to Linux mostly community. And that has some facilities. I am going to use them, okay? Not deactivate them to start. And then I'm going to separate the application from the core OS. And that's a very important point. We all know the principle now very well because Android has made that very common practice. Where the application are not part of the OS, Chrome OS as well. So we start to get used to the concept, but in embedded is new. In embedded, we used to have the application built in the OS, as one package, one big blob, and that was the system. That's not really viable in security, which has some side effect. Obviously, if you have applications separated from the OS, it means you have to get an application framework. Okay, there is today no standard application framework in Linux embedded. There are candidates. I will show you one for automotive, which could be used for other industry. You have to create default policy. So you have to get a packaging with say what is going to be authorized, because a good principle is that everything which is not explicitly authorized is strictly forbidden, which means that you have to know what you are going to authorize, which are typically policy. And finally, you have to manage all the signing hassle to know where your code is coming from and should it be running here and who has done it and so on, which is actually more complex than it seems to. So, do we know what we can trust? You can only know what you can trust if you have a valid chain of trust, which has to start with a trusted boot. So there's no alternative to that. If you are permanently connected, which was the case when I was working with set-top boxes, you can find some shortcut around that. But for most of the devices, without activating the trusted boot and without having a very valid chain of signature, you will never know if you can trust anything, because your base will be very unstable and you will be building on top of mud. You have to separate the application installation from your OS, and you have to have an update system. And that update system should validate that updates are only coming from a trusted origin. Because if you install a faked update, you know, you are not really progressing very well. I will make one specific point on container, and people want later, we could talk privately from container. Container are not the miracle solution, especially when you come to update, because you have no control of what gets in the container. So it's a big side effect, but you have to really think about that. Once you know what you can trust, you're going to do a layer architecture. And here's the idea, is that you are going to start to make a model in such a way that if you get one part of your system broken in, which is not more if, but rather when, the guy cannot move from one place to another one. And so obviously the most untrusted part is everything dealing with the outside world. So most of the time, the UI, it could be an API if it's a system which is UI-less. But what is dealing with the outside world is really what you cannot trust. And so you have to isolate that very well. And the best is to isolate it by providing APIs where you have defined services which are acceptable for that application. We started the first system I worked on, which had that, and embedded, was Tizen. It came from Samsung. Well, they had a very basic principle to say that application can do this, can do that, and can do that, and that's it. And every time it will try to do something else, it would be rejected. Then you have the services, and the services quite often are part of the OS, and they are trusted. That is something that is less and less acceptable. Ideally, you want to be able to treat your services like your application, in such a way that you don't really trust them completely, and you install them outside of the OS, and you run them in a domain which is contained. And this is really interesting, because it means that if someone breaks into your service, it doesn't have the capability to spread out on the side. Because otherwise, if you have a Bluetooth daemon, and I take Bluetooth as an example, because it's a code which is extremely complex, if someone can break into it and you run Bluesy as root, which most of people do, if you break in it, you are root. And if you have not layered your system in such a way that root is not capable to do anything, which most of people let root be the king, then you are in and you are the king. So this is how actually the big hacking through video camera happened. People came through a very side effect maintenance and became root, and from root, they changed the VLAN on which the camera was connected. Hey, yes, it's very easy once you're root. And then they could listen at another VLAN, and they could go on the management of the router, and then they could patch the router and progress that way. So you definitely want that. This is a bit difficult to implement, but you have OSIS which does it. And finally, obviously, at one time, you have a platform and a system services that you have to trust. So the trick to be able to trust that part is to make it as small as possible. So the more you're going to add services, application, and extra on top of your very basic core system, the more you're going to take risk. So what do you want in your core system? Absolutely the minimum. The trusted boot, the base kernel, the file system, and then the daemon to load your services, half trusted, the application framework to log your application, completely untrusted. That's what you want in your core OS. I talked a little bit about update. I did a project a few years ago which had the capability to cut every single telephone line in 30 million houses in the UK. Believe it or not, I had a security guy on my back for quite a long time. He was very worried that someone would hack the system and actually would cut the telephone in the 30 million of houses in the UK. And one thing we learned out of that was that the only defense we had in case of trouble was update. The trick was, how could we do an update on a system which is already compromised? And that's what you need to think. A lot of people are thinking about update, how I'm going to optimize, how I'm going to make it quicker, how I'm going to be able to roll back. Yes, all of that is nice to have, but it's not critical. The only thing which is really critical is, how can I upgrade a system which has already been compromised? Which is a far more complex proposition. And you have to think about that, how to do it. The way we did it in British Telecom was that the upgrade software was actually not on the box. The only thing we had on the box was a capability to download the software that actually would be the upgrade software. So when the upgrade software was downloaded, if we had some specific things we had to do before we can upgrade, we actually had the capability to get them. So it was coming after. And that was not perfect. You know, we did that system 15 years ago, and at the time, the risks were not as bad as today. But you will still have to think about that. You have to sign it, and you have to think how your keys are going to be. Protecting keys is a very serious challenge. You cannot trust anyone, especially you cannot trust your manufacturing if you are manufacturing in a low-cost country. In a high-cost country, you cannot trust them much, but in a low-cost, even less. And it's a problem. So you have to really think at the complete chain of protection of keys in that area. And obviously, non-reproducibility, you don't want someone cracking one device to crack all devices. That's not acceptable. Now, sometimes with mass stuff, you have to do it. But if you can afford to have in your update system something which is specific to that device, it can be quite simple. You know, it can be just one file that when the request comes has the ID of the device, and you add that in a file and you push it just in such a way that it makes more difficult to reproduce identical by just replaying memory. It will increase your resilience quite a lot. So, I've been talking in general. I will take a practical example, automotive-grade Linux. Automotive-grade Linux is a distribution that could be called industrial IoT Linux. It's fundamentally a Linux which is secure, provide display management, and has an application framework. To be honest, it doesn't have much specific to automotive, except that it fits that requirement. It's been derived from Tizen 2, and they have done quite a few interesting improvements in certain area. So service isolation, obviously, you can use systemd to start your services, and you can drop privileges. You can activate mandatory access control. In AGL, it's done through SMAC. You have C group, which can stop people to eat all your CPU, all your RAM. And namespaces can be used to further force isolations. So in one way, there is no magic there. It's just organization. Now, if you do that the first time on an OS, I can tell you when you're going to boot, nothing is going to work. Okay. Because write will be wrong. So it's that where it's interesting to work with people who have done it. More interesting is to segregate application from the OS. And AGL went a bit further in the sense that they not only segregate the application, which is something we were already doing in Tizen, they also segregate the services. And that is done through the application manager, which is capable to load the applications, to run them, to start them. But when they are started under the control of the security manager. And fundamentally, what the security manager does is that when an application wants to use an API, it does check that the application at installation time was declared allowed to use that service. You all know that from your telephone? And apparently, if you use the small Android robots or the Apple, they have the same principle. Applications have privileges, which declare what an application can do. And so that's a basic principle. So obviously, this write has to be managed somewhere, and that is managed in Security Manager. And that has to be interfaced with the entire system to know every time you create an API that that API is dependent from a specific privilege. What is a bit original in the way it's been implemented in AGL is that the services have been implemented under a model of binder. So it's, in one way, it's an application which is running without UI. And you talk to that one through a WebSocket. You can use Dbus for legacy. But the real model is to use WebSocket. And so you have a REST API. And that REST API is managed like you would do in the cloud. So you have a token system. And that token is passed to the application at the initialization. And if that token, if this is broken, it stopped to work, which means that if a fake application would try to use a socket which has been opened by a valid application, it would be rejected. That's quite unique in embedded world. It's unique in the sense that it once provide a very nice level of control and isolation, because it really stops someone who would become valid to run an application in the system, obviously a fake crook application, would have difficulty to actually eat resources which have been established by other applications. In that point, it's interesting. It's also interesting in the sense that it does rely on the technologies that web developers know. And remember what I said at the very beginning. We don't have enough engineers to actually develop IoT devices. So the fact to implement the security model on a concept which is known and understood by 9 million developers is very interesting. Because that means you can actually pull all these guys to start to do embedded, and not only to do embedded, but to do secure embedded. Oh, I didn't want to go further. So practically, this is the way it's implementing. And I give an example. So the transport and access control is done through WebSocket. The access is done through Open Authentication too. And then you can have services, and that these services, for example, navigation service, can do the map handling, the point of interest. It doesn't have to be the UI. And a service can call on another service, which means that you can actually extend an AGL core to become what you want to be. Most of people today try to do something in cars with it, which with automotive grade Linux is not surprising. But as I told you, it could be very well an industrial controller for a machine. And you actually run them on top of this transport and actually call them. Now, every service is controlled with a Mac. So if you have not looked at mandatory access control, there are three which are very popular. SE Linux, which is very well known because Red Hat use it. AppArmor, which is used by Ubuntu and OpenSUSE. and SMAC, which is used in mostly embedded devices for reason that it does a little bit same thing, but smaller. It's used by Philips originally in television. It's used in every Samsung Tizen device, so more or less every TV, watches, and gadget done by Samsung today is using it. And it's used in AGL. But they do the same thing. They're more or less what you have, you attach to an executable, a label, and that label will define what that executable is capable to touch. So it's really a control. And the executable does not have the capability to change it by itself. It's not like access control. When I put an access control, I have the capability to change it. So if I become root, I can decide that anyone will be able to read a file. Not with Mac. With Mac, you know, it's a bit more tightly controlled. And anyone who has tried to play with it knows that it can be a bit painful on the configuration because it requires you to be extremely well organized. But the beauty with a ready-made system like AGL is that they provide it for you. Now, how does it work in the application framework logic? It's very simple. The application is having a binder client and can actually even embed a binder service if you want. So your application can be having a fairly wide, if you want, domain. But it runs in a specific isolation control. So that application could only talk through the standardized transport to other services. So if that application required other services, it will call on them through the transport system, which, as I told you, is mostly based on WebSocket or Dbus for legacy. And these services could themselves daisy chain that. So it created a little bit of heaviness in the system. And this transport is using JSON. So once again, a technology that a web developer knows, so we can pick up them. We looked at what is the cost of it, because when you look at that, say, oh, this is really tough, you know, it's going to put my embedded system down. It's actually not bad at all. We could, on small, medium-sized CPU, I did the test on a Meego board, and my friend Stefan, who is at the end, did the test on the Porter board, which is from Renesas. Results are roughly equivalent, you know, we could manage about 30,000 exchange of data per second, so it's not bad, because these are small CPUs. So it would fit most of usage even on a small CPU, so the cost is not prohibitive at all. If you use Dbus, it will put your system down very quickly. Okay, WebSocket is significantly quicker than Dbus. Now, when you write an application, what are the side effects of it? The first time, you will have to decide what your application has a right to do. That's a very important point, because that will define the privileges that you're going to request. And if you don't know what your application has to do, then you better not write it anyhow. So you will access to your services through WebSocket, mostly. You will have your own RAN domain. That's done by the application framework. You don't have to do that. And so you typically write the front end. Our advice is that you run the front end, and we like HTML5 because then you can write, you know, these one-page applications with this very nice framework that people use today. And it's interesting because it allows to make very nice application. It allows to debug running on a PC while you are connected to a WebSocket, to your embedded development platform, which is really luxury. But it's also possible to develop with other technology. It's not linked to HTML5. So you can use QML for people who are using Qt, or you could use anything else, to be honest. At the end of the day, it doesn't really matter. And you're going to use REST APIs to talk with your services. Once you have done that, you're going to make a package, and that package is based on W3C widget, on which you have to add what you need as privileges. And you shake all of that, and then this is going to be installed by the application framework independently from the OS. That's a very important point to remember. So So that's the only thing you have to do special. So that's what we have today. Today, if you go on the website from AGL, you will find AGL 2.0 candidate. And you will have an application framework, and you will have capability to play with that. Where we're going on? Now that we have a transport system which is working on WebSocket, we can actually work in different manner. We can have multiple CPU talking together in a network, or we can work with the cloud. There is no need to have the service which is on the embedded device. It becomes completely transparent. So we have the capability to extract services, send them to the cloud as well as we'd run them locally as long as we are connected, because the technology we're using is technology which is very common in the cloud area. So that's the next step that should come, I would say, reasonably quickly, in the sense that it's more an implementation detail than a real architecture change. The architecture we have done is already doing that job. The next step is a bit more complex. Especially I like it because working for Intel, virtualization is a domain where we are pretty strong. We believe that there is an interest to actually allow virtualization to run in this type of environment at very low level, especially when you want to deal with safety functional applications. Functional safety is out of reach for Linux today, and it's likely going to be out of reach for quite a bit of time. So by running a very low-level hypervisor, we could have capability to have some functional safety compliant application running on the same hardware. But on the other side, we could run as well as a client of AGL, another operating system, which is potentially more friendly to what we want to do, for example, to games. Okay, and then we could have the system which is running, you know, the basic application, but you want to have a game on the side. You may not want to run it on the same OS and have to manage all the codec issues and potential risks. So having a virtual machine is a very strong interest. So as a conclusion, technology for implementing a decent security are available already. So all the excuses for not doing it because it's not available are no good. The management is not more ready than the engineering. And they are still capable to push it out. And engineering sees as a security as a break for innovation, and that is really wrong. I've been in security for quite a bit of time, and I can tell you there is a lot of innovation in security. It may not be as sexy as doing UI work, because typically people don't see what you do. But I can tell you, for your paycheck at the end of the month or for finding job, it's a very good one. So there is a lot of innovation, and there is a lot of opportunities which are there. The complexity is there, complexity is huge, and I would not advise, I would actually disadvise you to try to do it by yourself. You should take a ready-made implementation. And it doesn't matter if you go with AGL, obviously we do AGL, so that's the best, and Stéphane agrees with me. But if you go Philippe on the side, he's working on Tizen, you know, Tizen also has a security model. And even Snappy has a security model from Ubuntu. It's based on containers, so it's a bit, in one way, less secure. It's more difficult to manage because you don't have any control of what gets in the container when you control the platform. But there are models which are viable. You know, try to do it by yourself, except if you really have an army of very skilled people, is likely a bad idea. With this, we may have a few minutes for questions. Yes?
Actually, I have a comment on that. You speak about your systems.
Yeah.
So then it's clear that the systems are not yours. They are actually owned by someone else in their car. So while I would like, if I buy a car, the car to be secure from outside attackers, at the point when you try to make the car secure from me, I own the car.
Yes.
I guess
No,
I
yeah.
Would not do that.
Would you be more happy if you would know that your system with your remote key control can be opened by anyone?
No.
No?
I don't want people to open my car, but I want to modify my car.
Ah, no, but that's different. Yes, you want to hack in. No. Yeah, no, okay, that's a very... Yes, that's a very valid question. I have known that question in TV for years. In TV, we had that problem for years. It is very clear that when you buy a device where people are committing to maintain it for you and are taking legal responsibility, that it is behaving in compliance with the law, you know that your car is not allowed to do things as soon as it moves at more than 2 kilometers per hour by law. If the car manufacturer ships you a system which could do that, he is actually liable. So if you want to hack your system in a car, like if you want to hack your TV, you will have to change the system. That's very clear. You are not going to get from a car manufacturer, from a TV manufacturer, from a telephone manufacturer, a device that delivered as it is easy to hack at low level because there are legal compliances that they cannot commit. And it's very unpleasant, I do agree.
So you are wrong, I get phone, which I'm allowed to hack?
Yes, you get phone, but that phone is actually not in theory legal to work on your country. Yes, that's a trick. So if you want to go outside of the law and you make a clear decision, that's perfectly possible. But don't expect any company or corporation to take that risk for you. Now, they may not lock it completely, but they are not going to take it.
The moment when you lock the device from its owner, then you create a pretty big incentive for the owner, that's me at this point, to break your security and make sure you don't get it back.
Yes. Yes, you're right. No, you're absolutely right. There is a part of population, which is a hacking populations, who will actually break into devices. They have been for years. They have been there. It will be there. I have been part of them. It's just a reality, but that's not a business reality of a manufacturer having to do it. If you are a service company and you have to develop a management system for a factory building, devices or making food, the fact that the guy can hack into it is the least of your problem. The fact that someone walking by the company is not capable to break in is far more important. But you're right, it's a break on that point. Other question? Yes? Okay, so the question is, if you create a system which has only one application, would you need all that complexity, if I translate your questions? Obviously, it's possible with a system running only a single application to simplify it. Now, you still have to develop a secure Linux. You still have to develop a secure update mechanism. So the cost of doing all of that specifically for you and to maintain it is likely going to be more than taking a ready-made Linux, which is secure, and to write a single application. So it's likely not that it is as critical in that type of situation, but all the things you have around make that likely it's still interesting because it comes ready-made with people who know how to use it, have documented it, and will maintain it for you. Yes? Yes.
50 or 500.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them, or many of them, would be very tiny and very constrained systems.
Yes.
You mentioned the point that some will only run Office, something like this.
Yeah.
Yet they could be dangerous if they're hacked.
Yes.
Some kind of a securitisation
Yeah, so the question is, if I translate it simply for people who will watch a video after that, is if you make a very small device which will not be capable to run a full Linux with all its complexity, is there some standard system or pattern to develop it secure? Yes, there are a few domains remain very true. The number one is that the update capability online must allow to update the system even if it has been compromised. So I would say with very small devices, the number one security is going to be, can I upgrade the system? And the number two, can I upgrade the system and not be sure that no one else upgraded for me with the wrong thing? If you have that, you already put yourself at a fairly reasonable level for small system, because you're likely not going to be able to do much more than that. And if you take, I take two examples, Zephyr, I know it's been sponsored by Intel, so I have to talk about it. But Embed as well, that I quite like because the user interface is really friendly. They both have a security model. Okay, it's not as sophisticated as that. It's designed to run a small OS with one application, but they still have ported the SSH, so they have the capability to use a kind of SSL implementation, so they can secure their communication. They have implemented a model of keys, and they have an update system. So that's the absolute minimum. If you don't have that, you're in serious risk. Time for last question. Yes?
One of your slides had a virtualized example of the graphics.
Yes.
Is that actually practical? Can the graphics performance be okay?
The question is virtualization viable from a performance point of view? Yes, in embedded world, okay. Virtualization has a cost. It's a bit, as I told you, our security model has a cost. It's not too high, but it has a cost. You know, we know that getting messages and getting security has a cost, which we tend to evaluate at around 10% of CPU, you know, roughly that what we think that gets eaten by the security model. Virtualization tend to be in the same range. So the low virtualization is very low. The one which are working on very low hypervisor, like Jailhouse from Siemens, which was presented on Tuesday here, those ones are very low. They are below 1%. But they do very little. Now, if you have a full virtualization, the cost can go anything from 3% to 15%. It depends how much you have in your hardware. And this is why I like virtualization, because been working for Intel, we have a lot of hardware helper which enable to reduce the cost of that virtualization. But if you have the right implementation with KVM, you can be as low as 5% of cost by running virtualization. So it depends what it provides you. 5% is a lot and little at the same time. If it allows you to run an OS that otherwise you would not be able to run, then it's cheap. If it allows you to provide a solution very quickly because the customer wanted to run Android and you had not planned it, okay, and you want to put Android in 3 weeks on top of your system, it's very cheap. And finally, I would say if you have to buy a more expensive CPU, which is more powerful, at Intel, we're quite happy with that. Okay, with this, thank you. The slide already on the website. And so I'll let you with that. If you have any question, you have my email.